the concept of consumers surplus is very important, which gives a comparative study of consumers who are better off in a country or they are not better off in another country. Within the country, how a consumer gets a surplus, that is an indication of standard of living. And therefore, this concept, of course it is a theoretical one, but has a great significance because we can compare different people or different countries, and on that basis we can determine consumers' surplus. We define consumer surplus as a difference between price prepared to pay minus the actual market price which was paid by the consumer in the market. The difference between the two is known as the consumer's surplus. Generally, when we go for market, we think of a higher price or the price we are prepared to pay. For example, a consumer wants to buy a laptop, and for a laptop, a consumer is prepared to pay 40,000 rupees. He goes to the market and purchases that laptop as per standard at 37,000 rupees. The difference of 3,000 rupees is consumer's surplus. Now one may say that supposing that in market price is 40,000, well, there will be no consumer surplus. Consumers surplus accrue when the price thought is higher than the price paid in the market. In other words, market conditions keep on changing, and by chance if a consumer gets less amount, well, difference is consumer surplus. Or you can say that people in those countries which are highly advanced, developed, they have a higher per capita income, they have a higher standard of living, they are prepared to pay a higher price. And when they pay less amount because of innovations, research and development in those countries, goods are available at a cheaper rate, therefore they get that consumer surplus. In underdeveloped countries, say, people are not prepared to pay higher price, therefore they get less consumer surplus. People who get more consumer surplus have a higher standard of living. People who get less amount of consumer surplus, they are not developed or they are living in an underdeveloped country. This concept is based on marginal utility. For example, we take say marginal utility from a particular commodity, supposing first unit is taken and marginal utility is say 100 rupees. Second unit gives say lower utility of 95, third unit gives 90 utility, fourth unit gives 85, fifth unit gives 80, sixth unit gives 75, and lastly seventh unit gives 70 utility. Actually, consumer is prepared to pay on the basis of marginal utility. Therefore, here in this column we take price, prepared to pay, and a consumer is ready to pay on the basis of utility. If this is 100 utility, means he is ready to pay 100 rupees. For second unit, he is prepared to pay 95 rupees. For the third unit, he is prepared to pay 90 rupees. For fourth, 85. For fifth, 80 rupees. For sixth unit, he is prepared to pay 75 rupees. For seventh unit, he is prepared to pay 70 rupees. Now it should be clear that there is a different price level for different units, because intensity of want is different, therefore marginal utility is also diminishing, the money you are prepared to pay is also diminishing. Now consumer goes to the market and he finds that market price in the market is 70 rupees and market price at a particular time will be equal, it will be same 70 rupees. It will not change at that particular point of time. And if you want to buy 7 units, you negotiate with the shopkeeper and you say that okay, this price should be the same 70 rupees. Therefore, for all units, you pay 70 rupees. And in that case, difference between the price you were prepared to pay and the price you pay, that difference is known as consumer's surplus. Now come back to first unit. First unit gives 100 marginal utility. Therefore, you are prepared to pay 100 rupees, but you paid 70 rupees. This means for the first unit, you are getting a consumer surplus of 30 rupees. Look at the second unit. Second unit gives 95 utility. Now, you are prepared to pay 95 rupees, you pay 70 rupees. Therefore, difference between the price prepared to pay and the market price is known as the consumer's surplus. Therefore, the consumer's surplus is 25 rupees. And similarly, we calculate by looking at the difference. 90 and 70 difference is 20. 80 and 70 difference is 10. This is 5. 85 and 70. This is say 15, 80 and 70, 10, 75 and 75, and here you don't get any surplus because the market price and the price you are prepared to pay are both similar, and therefore there will be no consumer's surplus. Now this is how we base this particular concept on marginal utility. Now this table can give a diagram, or in other words, we draw marginal utility plus the price we are prepared to pay, and accordingly we draw this diagram on x-axis. We show units of a commodity, here we show marginal utility and price also. Now first unit gives 100 utility, so we join 100 and first. Second unit, utility is 95. Third unit, 90. Fourth unit gives 85. Fifth unit, 80. Sixth unit, 75. And seventh unit, 70. Therefore, market price is up to 70. This is the market price. But you are prepared to pay a higher amount. In other words, for the first unit, you are prepared to pay 100 rupees. For second, 95, then 90, 85, 80, 75, and 70. And for all these units, 1 to 7, you have paid 70 rupees. That means the price over and above 70 was not paid by the consumer. Therefore, this area which I mark as shaded area, that will be the consumer's surplus. This is how we calculate consumer's surplus, that the price you are prepared to pay and the actual price which you pay, the difference between the two is known as the consumer's surplus. Now the same concept can be explained with the help of a demand curve, where we have demand for a particular unit. We draw a demand curve, and on that demand curve we indicate that a consumer wants to buy n number of units, and for those n number of units he is prepared to pay a particular price. So price prepared to pay on a particular demand curve and the price which he actually pays in the market, difference between the two will be the consumer's surplus. For example, as per the law of demand, we draw a demand curve. Here we show price, here we show units or quantity, and we draw a demand curve which is always sloping downwards to the right. This is a demand curve, and on this demand curve, supposing for 5 units you are prepared to pay 80 rupees. So for 5 units you are prepared to pay a price of 80 rupees. This is the price you are prepared to pay. At the same quantity you get at 75 rupees. Therefore, market price is 75. Difference between the two, 5 rupees is the consumer's surplus, which is given as a shaded area in this diagram. It should be clear that a consumer wanted to pay 80 rupees, but he actually paid 75 rupees in the market. Therefore, the difference of 5 rupees is known as the consumer's surplus. This is how we can take a demand curve, and on that demand curve we can indicate the price prepared to pay and the actual price which is paid. The difference is known as the consumer's surplus. All of you know that market price is subject to fluctuations. There may be number of fluctuations in the prices, and if price fluctuates, well, the consumer surplus will also change. Therefore, we can even indicate changes in price of that product and changes in consumer surplus. Now, in that case, if price changes, then quantity demanded may also change. In other words, we have a seesaw game where we apply law of demand, lower the price, higher the demand, higher the price, lower the demand. On that basis, fluctuations in price will change the quantity demanded on the same demand curve. For the sake of better explanation, we take a demand curve which is a straight line, and we assume the price which you are prepared to pay, and then we assume different market prices, and accordingly we make a comparison. For example, on this diagram, supposing demand curve is a straight line, and on this demand curve you want to consume 10 units, and for these 10 units you are prepared to pay 100 rupees. This is the price you are prepared to pay. You go to the market and you get the same commodity at say 80 rupees. On this particular point, on a demand curve, you are paying 80 rupees. This is price line. 80-80 is the price line. That means that you have paid this money in the market, that is the market price of 80 rupees. Now just see that on this diagram you were prepared to pay 100 rupees, but you paid 80 rupees. Therefore, a triangle is formed, and this particular triangle will be the consumer's surplus. In other words, consumer's surplus is point A, D, E. At 80 rupees price line, A, D, E is the consumer's surplus. Now maybe that price falls, and if price falls to 70 rupees, well, another triangle is formed and consumer surplus increases to point B. And since price has fallen, therefore you buy more. That is, now you buy 110 units. With a fallen price, you reshuffle your consumption. And since more funds are available, because of a change in price, of course money income has not changed, but the real income has increased because of a fall in price. Therefore, at B point, you save 30 rupees, because at this B point, price you were prepared to pay was 100 minus 70 is equal to 30 rupees, or the next triangle which you get is B, D and F. This is the new triangle, and with this new triangle, consumer surplus has increased. With increased consumption from 100 to 110, this is how you buy more and you get more surplus. And reverse to this, supposing that price increases to 90 rupees. The price line is 90 rupees. Well, the consumer surplus will shrink from this point G and H. At 90 rupee price, the new consumer surplus will be DGH. New triangle is formed. And since price has risen, the law of demand is applicable. Higher the price, lower the demand. Therefore, demand goes down from 100 units to 90 units. This is how we can explain changes in price and changes in consumer surplus followed by a change in consumption. That means there are simultaneously two changes which we will have to notice. Now this concept is very important for a monopolist, for foreign trade, and this is important for a finance minister also, and also to compare people in different countries just to find out the level of their standard of living. A monopolist can charge a higher price, where consumers are likely to get higher consumer surplus. Foreign trade, if consumers from foreign countries are prepared to pay a higher price for, say, antiques, or handicraft items which we are exporting. Say from Udaipur we are exporting marble table drops with granite, which is carved out and fixed on that marble table top. Consumers in USA are prepared to pay a very high price for such marble table tops. We are exporting. Therefore, we can charge a higher price because they are likely to get more consumer surplus. Similarly, a finance minister can charge more tax from those goods, those people who consume luxury goods, and for that they are prepared to pay a higher price. Therefore, a finance minister can keep in view that if a higher price is paid by consumers, well, they get more consumer surplus and hence they can charge more taxes on those goods. But if a commodity is of general consumption, a finance minister will not put taxes because that involves masses and he cannot take that risk of charging a higher rate of tax from masses. He cannot annoy larger masses. Better he would give concession in taxes for those goods. Subsidy is given in our country for bare essential goods. Therefore, the knowledge of this concept will help a finance minister also to determine prices, determine taxes, indirect taxes which are to be charged. Therefore, this concept is very useful for different section of the society, and accordingly one can maximize revenues, maybe monopolist or an exporter or a finance minister.